Kaixo, bienvenido, willkommen, Cade Mila Falcha, that's Irish. Welcome, bienvenue, welcome ministers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues. On behalf of all of us here in EU-OSHA, may I extend a very warm welcome to you all to the beautiful city of Bilbao and to our Healthy Workplace Summit 2015. We have quite a program lined up for you, and we hope you will find the day and tomorrow stimulating, engaging, and provocative. We have interpreters here to help us communicate better over the next days. The languages available are English, French, Spanish, and German. So you need to have your headsets. If you haven't got them, go and get them very soon. They're available outside because we will be using and speaking in different languages. Before we start, let me remind you of the safety instructions. In case the alarm sounds, and I really hope it doesn't, please stay calm. Exit through the doors here on the right or on your left. Don't take any elevator. Follow the instructions of the emergency teams. Get out of the building and convene at the meeting point, which is the park opposite the main entrance. So we are streaming this event live on the web today, on the World Wide Web. How exciting is that? So keep your makeup on, keep your hair combed, because you never know when your face might be transported across the four corners of the globe. If any of you are here without your parents' permission, it might be a good time now to phone home. For those of you on Twitter, we have our very own hashtag. You can see it at the bottom of the slide there, hashtag EUOSHA Summit. Please tweet, retweet, and favorite tweets so that we can keep our conversations going online. That would be nice. Please be polite, even when we upset you up here. Just keep it clean. So we have lots of interesting people lined up for you this afternoon to open our conference. Now, I'm not going to ask any of those people about workplace stress. Why? Because the subject is an extremely serious one, and that is why we're dedicating today and tomorrow to the examination of workplace stress and managing stress in our workplaces. I am curious, though. I'm curious about these people. I'm nosy. I'm not proud of this, but I am curious about them. And I want to know, what do they do in their spare time? If they're feeling a bit stressed, where do they go to at nighttime or in the evenings? What allows them to relax, de-stress, chill out? Now, the first person to answer that question will be our first speaker today, our director, Christa Sedlatschek. As you all know, Christa was appointed director of EU-OSHA in September 2011. She had already worked in the agency before, so it was a little bit like coming back home for Christa. Before she came back to us, she was working for 8 years in Berlin with BAUA, where she was director of the National Initiative New Quality of Work, INQUA. Christa is a medical doctor, a labor inspector, and a specialist in occupational medicine. Now, in answer to our question, What do you do at home to totally chill out? Christa gave us an answer in three parts. Do you think this is an Austrian characteristic? So firstly, Christa said she does lots of sport. Secondly, she reads a lot in her downtime, but only proper books, the old-fashioned kind that are made of paper. No screen reading, no tablet downloading, no Kindle staring. And thirdly, Christa relaxes by spending time with her family and her friends. It sounds to me like a very good three-pronged approach to relaxing. So now, Christa, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Brenda, for this nice introduction. And welcome, the distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Ongi etori bilbora, buenas tardes y bienvenidos. Thank you all for attending the Healthy Workplaces Summit here today. And I'm very pleased to see so many of you to come to Bilbao. Before beginning, please allow me to introduce some strong and very valued supporters of this campaign, each of whom will make an opening statement. We will start with the Commissioner Marianne Thyssen, the Commissioner for Employment, Social Affairs, Skills and Labour Mobility. It's a pity, but Marianne is not able to be here in person, but instead she has sent us a video message. Then welcome to Nicolas Schmit, Minister of Labour, Employment and the Social and Solidarity Economy, representing the Luxembourg EU Presidency. Then bienvenido a Pedro Llorente, Deputy Secretary for Employment and Social Security, representing the Spanish government. And ongi etori a Angel Toña, Minister of Employment from the Ministry of Employment, as of course the Minister of Social Policy, representing the Basque government. Then welcome to Esther Lynch. She is representing the European Trade Union Confederation. She is a Confederal Secretary. And last but not least, Kris, Meester, Chair of the Health and Safety Group from BusinessEurope. Ladies and gentlemen, a good psychosocial environment is crucial for a healthy, happy, and productive workforce. No economic sector, whether public or private, large or small, rural or urban, is exempt from this general truth. The aim of our campaign has been to raise awareness about the growing problem of work-related stress and psychosocial risk. In addition, it has provided tools for tackling the risks themselves. This is perhaps the area where the campaign has had its most positive effect, reinforcing throughout Europe the message that stress and psychosocial risk, although more challenging, can be tackled with simple and practical tools. There is one profound lesson that I have learned from this campaign that I would like to share with you. This arose because I attended both the official Campaign Partners Award ceremony in Brussels and the Good Practice Award in Riga. For me, these events were an eye-opener and very encouraging. There was a very clear understanding among the companies and organizations present that stress could have unimaginable consequences, from lower productivity and poor decision-making right across the board to raised absenteeism, and serious health problems. At the same time, there was also a clear understanding that doing nothing was not an option. Smart companies tackled the problem head on, and there were occasions over this campaign where I was surrounded by very smart companies. They were not afraid to admit the problem. They were not afraid to recognize it, to identify the causes of stress, and together with their workforce were absolutely determined to eradicate it. It is self-evident that stressful situations can arise at any time. A topical example that affects many European countries is the current migrant crisis. Our colleagues in the European agency Frontex report that 700,000 migrants entered the EU in the first 9 months of 2015. Compare this with 282,000 recorded in all of 2014. Demanding situations such as this can stretch resources and create numerous physical and psychosocial risks. Reflect, please, on all those people involved in the difficult work of border management and refugees support in 2015, and consider what kind of help you would need if you were one of those frontline workers doing this incredibly difficult work. We believe that our campaign has been highly successful in providing a framework to address these risks, and the high level of interest confirms it. Thank you for your part in this achievement, and if you represent one of the national focal points, then I have a special thank you. Once again, your links with the national networks and your activities have been central to the success of the campaign. I cannot thank you enough for your participation in and commitment to what has been accomplished. Finally, I would like to honor the memory of our dear colleague, Dr. Eusebio Real González. He died almost 1 year ago on the 18th of December 2014 in his hometown of Vigo. Seb, as he was known to all of us, was the main architect of this campaign. Throughout the summit, you will hear a lot about him, starting with a session this afternoon on his legacy to fellow OSHA professionals. This summit, therefore, is also about celebrating his life and memory and honoring his achievements, which were substantial and included the design and launch of ESENA, the European Survey of Enterprises on New and Emerging Risk, and the establishment of OSHWiki, among others. Seb, we miss you. We miss your generosity and your humor. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy today and tomorrow. I hope that you will find the summit inspiring and not at all stressful. And I truly hope that it will provide you with the opportunity to meet new colleagues and renew friendships. So let's get started. And once again, thank you very much for joining here in Bilbao.
Thank you, Christa. Well, Marianne Thyssen is the European Commissioner for Employment, Social Affairs, Skills and Mobility. As Christa said, the diary prevented her from coming today, but she very kindly prepared a message for us. She herself has said to be extremely exercised by the topic of managing workplace stress. Before her appointment by President Juncker last year, Mrs. Thyssen was a member of the European Parliament for several years, and before that, and indeed still is, very active in politics in Belgium as part of the Flemish Christian Democrats. So let's hear now what Marianne Thyssen has to say to us today.
Ladies and gentlemen, although I am not able to join you here in person today, I am grateful for this opportunity to address you on the occasion of the Healthy Workplaces 2015 Summit. Stress is one of the most challenging issues at work. Every second worker in Europe today considers stress to be common in their workplace. It contributes to around half of all lost working days. It goes without saying that this can bear a huge cost to the individual in terms of health and quality of life, but also to employers in terms of keeping their companies productive. Work-related ill health can cost European member states anything from 2.6 to 3.8% of their GDP, according to a study of our European Agency for Safety and Health at Work. We need to take concerted action for healthy workplaces, including for mental health at work. That is why I want to say a word of praise, in particular about the 2014-15 campaign on managing stress at work. Like many other issues surrounding mental health, stress is often misunderstood or stigmatized. Creating space to talk about mental health issues is crucial in this respect. Companies, in particular the smaller ones, need to know what available tools exist and can be successfully applied to their workplace. Investing in prevention pays off and is highly cost-effective. I believe this year's campaign has greatly contributed to the raising awareness across Europe about what companies can do to better manage stress at the workplace and organize its prevention. European labor markets are changing fast in the face of technological innovation, modernization, and globalization. To protect our workers against the risks of today and tomorrow, it is necessary also to keep our legislation up to date. Since day one, the Commission has been working to deliver on this front, and in the Commission Work Programme for 2016, I am very pleased to tell you that every initiative that will be tabled will be sealed by a strong social dimension. I wish you all a successful event and look forward to hearing the outcome of your discussions. Thank you.
So there we have it from Commissioner Thyssen, whom I hope we will get the opportunity to welcome to Bilbao at some future point. It is now my great pleasure to introduce you to Nicolas Schmit, Minister of Labour, Employment and the Social and Solidarity Economy, representing here today the Luxembourg EU Presidency. His academic background in the arts and international relations is impressive, and he holds a doctorate in economics from the Faculty of Law and Economics of Aix-Marseille. Since the 2004 elections in Luxembourg, Minister Schmit has held office in government in various roles, starting as Minister Delegate for Foreign Affairs and Immigration, to his current position as Minister of Labour, Employment and the Social and Solidarity Economy. Now, when I asked Minister Schmit, "What do you do in your free time?" he looked completely puzzled and he said, "Do I have free time?" And then he said, "Yes, I remember I had free time before Luxembourg took over the presidency of the EU Council. So back then, when he had free time, the thing he loved to do most was walk in the beautiful Luxembourgish countryside, accompanied by his three dogs. And he said, nothing can distress you more and wind you down than a walk in the woods with your dogs. The floor is yours, Minister Schmit.
Madame la directrice, messieurs les ministres, moi je suis extrêmement heureux d'être ce soir avec vous, d'être à Bilbao. C'est pour la première fois que je me trouve ici et je suis vraiment, j'éprouve un grand plaisir de participer à cette conférence qui, je crois, souligne d'abord votre engagement pour une cause fondamentale, mais qui donne aussi à l'Europe cette image de sociale dont elle a absolument besoin. Et le thème que vous avez maintenant promu depuis deux ans, qui vise précisément à gérer, à mieux gérer les risques psychosociaux au travail et si possible les éviter, puisqu'il faut les prévenir. Vous, en tant que médecin, vous savez que la meilleure façon de guérir, c'est de ne pas avoir la maladie, c'est de prévenir la maladie. Je crois que c'est un sujet qui, malheureusement, affecte trop de salariés, puisque j'ai vu dans vos statistiques des millions d'Européens, des millions de salariés européens se disent en quelque sorte victimes du stress. Et c'est bien sûr un enjeu d'abord individuel, puisque le stress mène souvent à des maladies, à d'autres maladies. Ce stress, bien sûr, déstructure parfois la vie de ceux qui en souffrent. Le stress pèse sur les familles, mais le stress, bien sûr, a aussi une dimension économique. Et là aussi, vous avez fait des recherches et qui évaluent l'impact du stress sur les entreprises, sur la productivité, sur le bon fonctionnement des entreprises et bien sûr aussi sur les finances publiques à travers les absences qu'ils causent et les coûts au niveau de la sécurité sociale. Donc je crois que l'enjeu de cette conférence et l'enjeu de ce travail que vous avez mené depuis deux ans est un enjeu tout à fait capital. Et montre aussi que, comme je l'ai dit déjà, que l'Europe n'est pas uniquement une entité économique, même si c'est important de mettre toujours l'accent sur la performance économique. Bien sûr, il ne faut pas oublier les valeurs, il ne faut pas oublier les valeurs humaines. Et je crois que ce n'est comme cela que nous réussirons aussi à concilier, et parfois aussi à réconcilier, les citoyens européens avec le grand projet européen. Donc, permettez-moi d'exprimer mes félicitations, mes remerciements pour le travail accompli par votre agence, car en effet, votre agence apporte une contribution précieuse à la santé et à la sécurité des travailleurs en Europe. Et je dirais au-delà de l'Europe, puisque vous réussissez à être en quelque sorte un trendsetter pour tout ce qui touche à la sécurité et à la santé au travail. Vous montrez la voie qu'il faut suivre pour effectivement faire des lieux de travail, des lieux où, qui ne rendent pas malades, parce qu'il y a quelque part une contradiction de penser que le travail rend malade. L'agence a montré son attachement à une stratégie active et dynamique pour améliorer les conditions de travail, et ce notamment grâce à son initiative phare en matière de sensibilisation. Les campagnes sur les lieux de travail sains, qui sont devenues un moyen de choix pour véhiculer le message de sécurité et de santé sur les lieux de travail en Europe, et ce, depuis le lancement de la première campagne en 2000. De par cette campagne, il a notamment été possible de briser des tabous et d'éliminer des stigmatisations qui subsistaient autour des problèmes de santé mentale, dont le stress. Les enquêtes menées par l'agence ont fait ressortir que le stress au travail est le deuxième problème de santé lié au travail le plus fréquemment rapporté en Europe. Il représente près de la moitié de tous les jours de travail perdus, ce qui coûte à l'économie européenne des milliards. On parle de près de 140 milliards d'euros chaque année en raison de la perte de productivité et en raison de l'absentéisme pour congé de maladie. Par ailleurs, les données de l'étude Eisener 2, récemment publiée, révèlent que 53% des employeurs ont déclaré avoir insuffisamment d'informations sur la façon d'inclure les risques psychosociaux dans leurs évaluations des risques, confirmant que la plupart des employeurs estiment que les risques psychosociaux sont plus difficiles à gérer que les risques classiques sur le lieu de travail. Ils ont peut-être le sentiment que la santé mentale d'un employé est un point trop sensible, trop individuel à soulever, ou qu'ils n'ont pas peut-être les compétences nécessaires. Et je crois que tout ce que vous avez fait devrait aussi aider les employeurs à mieux gérer ces phénomènes. Cependant, les risques psychosociaux peuvent être évalués et gérés de la même manière systématique que les risques classiques sur le lieu de travail. C'est là tout le succès de la campagne, parce qu'elle a réussi à transmettre ce message à travers toute l'Europe, à travers le message « Les lieux de travail sains, un acquis pour vous, un acquis pour l'entreprise ». Il a été possible de combler le fossé entre l'incompréhension et la réalité en fournissant des informations et des outils pratiques à la fois aux employeurs et aux employés. Le succès de cette campagne est particulièrement louable à un moment où nous sommes confrontés à une pression croissante sur l'emploi et les conditions de travail. Il est cependant clair que sans de bonnes conditions de travail et des lieux de travail sains et sécurisés, il ne sera pas possible d'atteindre les objectifs ambitieux de croissance durable et inclusive que nous nous sommes fixés au sein de l'Union européenne. Moi, je pense qu'on parle beaucoup de compétitivité. Eh bien, il n'y a pas de compétitivité, il n'y a pas d'entreprise compétitive qui, finalement, fait peu de cas des accidents de travail ou qui accepte la dégradation de la santé des salariés, et notamment de la santé mentale. Donc, je pense que la lutte contre ces phénomènes-là, c'est aussi une lutte pour l'amélioration de la compétitivité, à la fois au niveau général comme au niveau de l'entreprise. C'est pourquoi ce sommet est important, car il nous permet de continuer à réfléchir tous ensemble sur les moyens que nous pouvons nous donner pour sensibiliser davantage toutes les parties prenantes sur la gestion du stress lié au travail et sur les risques psychosociaux. L'amélioration systématique de la santé et de la sécurité sur le lieu de travail est l'une des clés de voûte de la création d'emplois de qualité, de la croissance de la compétitivité et de la productivité des entreprises et de l'assurance de la cohésion de la protection sociale. C'est pourquoi elle a toujours été et doit rester l'un des éléments essentiels de la politique de l'Union. Cette longue tradition en matière de santé et de sécurité, qui a commencé avec le premier traité, le traité CECA, où finalement ces valeurs de santé et de sécurité étaient inscrites dans le traité, doivent être activement poursuivies. Il s'agit en fin de compte d'une contribution positive et non pas d'un fardeau pour les entreprises. La clé du succès économique aujourd'hui devient de plus en plus la capacité d'innovation, la créativité dans les entreprises. Eh bien, le stress finit par détruire ces capacités-là dont nous avons le plus besoin. L'environnement du travail doit donc éliminer ces facteurs négatifs. Il faut donc adapter l'organisation du travail, les instruments de reconnaissance aussi, un facteur très important pour l'état de satisfaction que les salariés trouvent dans leur travail, une flexibilité bien comprise qui prend aussi en compte, par exemple, les aspirations entre la conciliation de la vie professionnelle et de la vie familiale. Et en plus, surtout à une époque où la stabilité de l'emploi n'est plus assurée, la sécurisation des parcours professionnels est un autre aspect important, car la précarité déstabilise les salariés et n'est pas à plus long terme gage de productivité. Elle devient ainsi une cause de stress, de mal-être au travail. Les acteurs économiques sont de plus en plus nombreux à réaliser que de mauvaises conditions de travail, que la dégradation de la santé des salariés, que les accidents, en plus d'être moralement inacceptables, ont un coût économique pour l'entreprise et la collectivité. Nous voulons que l'entreprise devienne un vrai lieu de travail qui a aussi une responsabilité sociale. Une croissance équitable et équilibrée, fondée sur des emplois exercés dans des conditions de travail satisfaisantes et respectant la dignité du travailleur, est indispensable de la vie des citoyens, qui, de leur côté, attendent de l'Europe qu'elle montre concrètement comment elle peut améliorer leur vie de tous les jours. L'Europe que nous voulons est une Europe qui améliore les conditions de travail et qui aboutit à une convergence vers le haut entre les différents États membres. L'Europe a une immense responsabilité pour répondre aux attentes et aux besoins des citoyens européens, notamment sur leur lieu de travail. Quand nous parlons de triple A social, c'est aussi que c'est de cela qu'il s'agit. Trop souvent, l'Europe est amalgamée à une vaste entreprise qui vise à déréglementer le milieu du travail, qui met le marché avant les hommes et les femmes, qui préconise des réformes structurelles qui ne font que peu de cas de l'intérêt des salariés et de leurs droits. Ceci ne correspond pas au projet initial européen, qui a toujours allié efficacité économique et progrès social, un bon fonctionnement du marché et le respect des droits sociaux. C'est l'essence du modèle social européen qui n'a rien de suranné. Nous devons restaurer cet équilibre dont fait partie la promotion de la sécurité et de la santé, déjà inscrite, comme je l'ai dit, dans les premiers traités européens. Et dans ce contexte, je tiens à rappeler que l'approfondissement de la dimension sociale européenne est en haut de la liste des priorités de la présidence luxembourgeoise. Et nous attendons bien sûr, et Madame la Commissaire vient de le dire, que la Commission nous propose un certain nombre de nouvelles propositions, à la fois en matière de sécurité et de santé, mais aussi en matière de lutte contre toutes les formes qui déprécient le travail. Car un meilleur fonctionnement du marché intérieur est pour l'économie de l'Union européenne une priorité. Mais les progrès en matière de marché intérieur doivent être accompagnés de progrès en matière sociale, des règles claires, notamment aussi en matière de santé et de sécurité au travail. Cela vaut aussi en relation avec la mobilité. Nous attendons donc tous avec grand intérêt le paquet mobilité de la Commission. Il n'est pas acceptable que, par exemple, les travailleurs détachés soient souvent exclus des protections, qu'ils soient largement davantage victimes d'accidents de travail, ce qui est souvent le cas pour eux, mais aussi pour ceux qui ont par exemple un travail non déclaré, d'où d'ailleurs, sous présidence luxembourgeoise, tous les efforts qui sont déployés pour arriver à un accord sur la plateforme contre le travail non déclaré. J'aimerais mentionner aussi le phénomène de la digitalisation de l'économie, qui est probablement un des grands bouleversements qui est en train de se préparer et de se mettre en place. Eh bien, cette digitalisation de l'économie crée de nouvelles opportunités, mais peut aussi présenter de nouveaux risques en matière de conditions de travail notamment, et notamment aussi en relation avec le stress. Nous devons donc prendre davantage en compte cette dimension aussi au vu des évolutions dans ce domaine. Simplement pour vous dire, pour la présidence luxembourgeoise, c'est un grand plaisir d'être aujourd'hui avec vous. C'est un grand plaisir parce que nous avons déjà organisé à Luxembourg une conférence sur les conditions de travail de demain, qui a réuni d'ailleurs aussi votre propre agence, les partenaires sociaux, la Commission et d'autres acteurs, et qui a notamment mis l'accent sur le rôle important de sensibiliser, d'informer, mais aussi de contrôler. Donc un rôle important aussi pour les inspections du travail. Pendant notre présidence, nous avons également fait adopter par le Conseil, et je m'en réjouis et je m'en félicite, des conclusions sur les conditions de travail, marquant très clairement qu'il ne s'agit pas, dans ce domaine fondamental, de faire moins, de déréglementer. Parce que souvent, quand on parle de meilleure réglementation, en fait, on vise la déréglementation. Non, nous ne voulons pas déréglementer, nous voulons peut-être réglementer mieux et de façon plus appropriée, notamment en suivant mieux les évolutions en cours dans le milieu de travail, mais nous espérons que ces conclusions, bien sûr, vont également inspirer la Commission pour que, effectivement, cette Europe retrouve le triple A social et qu'elle regagne ainsi la confiance des citoyens. Je vous remercie.
Thank you very much. Thank you for those words, Minister Schmit, and thank you for the support of the EU Luxembourg presidency to the work of EU-OSHA. So now it's my great pleasure to introduce you to Pedro Llorente Cachorro, the Undersecretary for Employment and Social Security here in Spain. Mr. Llorente is a graduate in law and also in national defense studies. He has a distinguished career in politics in Spain, including time in the Ministry of Economy and Finance, the Ministry of Defense, and the Ministry of Health, as well as heading up several organizations, such as the municipal company Madrid Destination Culture, Tourism and Business, PLC, and also the State Society of Industrial Participation. So, how does Under Secretary Llorente relax in his spare time? Well, he runs, but he is no ordinary runner. He runs approximately 60 kilometers every week. How's that for impressive? And in addition, he said that if running doesn't bring him to other thoughts, there's another activity that does bring him to other thoughts, and that is playing with and looking after his four children. So please, the podium is yours.
Señoras y señores, componentes, miembros de esta mesa, delegados, expertos, destacados en esta cumbre, muy buenas tardes a todos. Me gustaría comenzar mis palabras en primer lugar agradeciendo la invitación de la directora de la Agencia Europea para la Seguridad y Salud en el Trabajo a esta cumbre, una cumbre sobre trabajos saludables y que supone el cierre de la campaña 2014-2015 que iba bajo el lema Gestionemos el estrés. Una campaña sobre la gestión del estrés y de los riesgos psicosociales en el trabajo, que fue precisamente elegida por ser el segundo problema de salud relacionado con el trabajo más frecuentemente denunciado en Europa. Yo creo que el rol de la Agencia Europea es esencial en este campo. Con las campañas que promueve, que apoya, contribuye de manera decisiva a la sensibilización y la concienciación sobre diversos aspectos de la seguridad y salud en el trabajo. La repercusión en España de las campañas de la agencia ha crecido notablemente en los últimos años y ha conseguido llegar a toda la sociedad, más allá del ámbito natural, de las empresas, de los trabajadores, para extender y reforzar algo tan importante como es la cultura preventiva en nuestro país. Hoy podemos constatar aquí el gran interés que ha despertado en nuestra sociedad esta campaña y, en especial, todo lo relacionado con los riesgos psicosociales. Y, por tanto, quiero agradecer el esfuerzo de todas las organizaciones que se han adherido a la misma durante estos dos años de trabajo intenso. Un interés que se corresponde con los datos de la última encuesta SNR 2, que identifica los conflictos relacionales como los factores de riesgo observados con mayor frecuencia, casi un 60%, en las empresas de la Europa de los 28. También me van a permitir que destaque que, conforme a estos datos de esta encuesta, el 88%, casi el 90% de las empresas españolas son conscientes de estos riesgos y realizan algo tan importante como es la evaluación de los mismos de una manera periódica frente a la media o superando la media de la Unión a 28. Estos dos años, como decía, debido a la acción importantísima impulsora de la Agencia Europea y también con el esfuerzo de la Red Española para la Seguridad y Salud en el Trabajo y de las organizaciones implicadas, se han realizado más de 140 actividades de apoyo en la presente campaña de trabajo saludables gestionemos el estrés y se han realizado en casi 50 ciudades españolas. También deseo destacar el certamen de los galardones europeos de las buenas prácticas que impulsa la agencia para dar a conocer en esa campaña de sensibilización los ejemplos de éxito para implantarlos con la mayor fortuna y eficacia y eficiencia en las empresas, organismos y otras entidades. Mis más sinceras felicitaciones a todos los participantes y muy especialmente a las empresas premiadas con la concesión de estos galardones europeos, porque con su contribución construyen un modelo participativo de prevención para prevenir los riesgos psicosociales que sería sin duda un claro ejemplo a seguir en el futuro. Señores y señoras, España desde hace muy poco, desde el mes de abril, tiene un nuevo marco de prevención de riesgos laborales. En el mes de abril, el Consejo de Ministros aprobó una nueva Estrategia Nacional de Seguridad y Salud en el Trabajo que abarca el horizonte del año 2015 a 2020. Es una buena estrategia, sinceramente lo creemos. Y es una buena estrategia porque parte de un acuerdo, de un consenso de todos los interlocutores sociales y las administraciones públicas concernidas. Y es una buena estrategia porque tiene, ha señalado, ha identificado objetivos claramente alcanzables con el esfuerzo de todos. No es algo que pueda destacarse o que pueda dejarse al albur de la incertidumbre, sino que esos objetivos han sido fijados con realismo, puesto que su consecución es posible durante estos 5 años. En estos últimos años, en el que se marca este instrumento, esta estrategia nacional, como colofón, como eslabón último de esta política en materia de protección de riesgos laborales, en mi país, en España, ha estado orientado no tanto a aprobar una legislación que data de la época de los años 90 y que ha sido actualizando periódicamente, sino también a algo tan básico como que las normas de prevención de riesgos laborales se cumplan. De nada nos sirve tener normas si al final no hacemos que éstas se puedan cumplir. Porque una mayor seguridad y salud en el trabajo es uno de los elementos de lo que venimos denominando la calidad en el empleo. Calidad en el empleo que aspiramos a que sea uno de los elementos centrales del mercado de trabajo en España. Para ello ha sido necesario poner en marcha nuevas políticas, como digo, de concienciación, de sensibilización social y, sobre todo, de formación de empresarios y trabajadores. Para la ejecución de estas políticas ha sido de especial utilidad el ejemplo que suponen las campañas anuales sobre riesgos o trabajos saludables, como la que hoy nos convoca anualmente y que impulsa la Agencia Europea para la Seguridad y Salud en el Trabajo. Y en esa labor ha sido especialmente valiosa el papel desarrollado por el Instituto Nacional de Seguridad e Higiene en el Trabajo, que, como saben, es el centro de referencia nacional en España de la Agencia Europea. La agencia ha contribuido decisivamente a consolidar y desarrollar el amplio acervo de la Unión Europea sobre seguridad y salud en el trabajo y a prevenir y evitar los accidentes en el trabajo y las enfermedades profesionales. El apoyo de España a la agencia es inequívoco y, como muestra, el pasado 31 de marzo del año 2014 tuve el honor de representar a mi país en la firma del acuerdo de sede de la agencia, concretando así el compromiso claro entre la Unión Europea y España. Pero junto a las actividades de divulgación e investigación de la agencia, debo resaltar también la importante contribución de una institución centenaria en nuestro país, como es la Inspección de Trabajo y Seguridad Social, precisamente para hacer visibles la aplicación de la normativa en materia de prevención de riesgos laborales y específicamente también respecto a los riesgos psicosociales en las empresas, en cualquier tamaño, pero fundamentalmente en las pymes, en las pequeñas y medianas empresas. Por ejemplo, hay que tener siempre en cuenta la dificultad de la detección de la enfermedad mental ligada al trabajo, pues no se refleja adecuadamente en las estadísticas de accidentes, a pesar de que se sabe que la organización del trabajo es el mayor factor causal de la siniestralidad laboral. Por ello, las comprobaciones de la Inspección de Trabajo en su actividad inspectora sobre las necesarias evaluaciones de riesgos psicosociales en las empresas y la aplicación de las adecuadas medidas preventivas en este campo son herramientas claves para avanzar en la mejora de la salud laboral de los trabajadores en Europa. Es claro, por tanto, también que la vigilancia y el control de los riesgos laborales, y entre ellos los psicosociales, exige el incremento y la especialización de los recursos humanos disponibles, en este caso, para la inspección. Y en este punto he de decir que en España se ha aprobado recientemente una ley ordenadora del sistema de inspección de trabajo y seguridad social que sustituye a una anterior, una buena ley del año 1997 y que entre uno de sus puntos medulares, entre uno de sus pilares básicos, es el refuerzo del personal inspector mediante la creación de una nueva escala de subinspectores de seguridad y salud laboral que intensificarán la tarea que vienen ya realizando los efectivos de la inspección de trabajo en mi país. Concluyo ya subrayando, insistiendo en el apoyo desde el Gobierno de España a todas las iniciativas que, como las campañas de trabajo saludables, son promovidas desde la Agencia Europea, y espero que estas jornadas pongan en valor y permitan visualizar lo mucho y bien que hace la Agencia Europea por la mejora continua de las condiciones de seguridad y salud de todos los trabajadores europeos. Muchas gracias.
Yeah, muchas gracias, señor Llorente, and thank you also from the agency to the Madrid government for the continued support you show us. Thank you. Now we are honored to welcome to the stage Ángel Toña Goenaga, who is the Minister for Employment and Social Policies of the Basque government. He holds a doctorate in economic science from Deusto University. In fact, you can practically see that university when you are outside this building and you look across the river. And indeed, he was a professor at the university. Among other roles, he has held here in public life, including advisor in the Council of Working Relations for Conflictive Collective Agreements and Deputy Minister for Employment in the Basque government. Now, when we asked him how he manages to relax on his day off, he told us that cycling is his passion. But he does it in a very safe way. And why? Because before the compulsory helmet law was brought in here, he was heading off cycling one day with his 7-year-old son without a helmet. And his 7-year-old son said to him, "Why are you not wearing a helmet?" And he said, "Well, it's nice weather and it's okay. We're not going out for too long." And his son said, "Seven, mind, if you don't wear it for you, then wear it for me." So not only is he a great cyclist, but he's clearly raising a family of very clever cyclists too. So we're delighted to welcome you here. Please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Arratsaldeon denori, eta benetan Bilbora eta Euskadira ongi etorriak. Ongi etorria, Monsieur le Ministre, zuzendari Christa Sedlatschek, subsekretario jauna Pedro Llorente, eta zuek denok gure gana etortzea gaitik. Itz batzuk gure bihotzeko eta gure bizitzako euskeraz egin behar dut, gutxi, ze hemen jenderik ba, ez da egongo ulertzekotan, baina behintzat guretzat hain garrantzitsua da, ezin dut hasi euskeraz baino. Eta eskerrak ere jardunaldi honetara hauetan parte hartuko dozuen hoi, eta zuen iritziak guretzat zain gelditzen gara. Quiero agradecer a la Agencia Europea de Seguridad y Salud en el Trabajo, a su directora, a Christa Sedlatschek, la invitación a participar en esta cumbre que se extiende también a este Gobierno vasco. Uno de los ámbitos de responsabilidad del departamento nuestro de empleo y políticas sociales que dirijo es el relativo a la salud y seguridad laboral de la población trabajadora de la comunidad autónoma del País Vasco, a través de nuestro organismo autónomo OSALAN. Como saben todos ustedes, expertos en estas áreas, se trata de un área compleja, difícil, pero les aseguro que es de extrema importancia, de extrema y nuclear importancia para el gobierno del que formo parte. En una coyuntura como la actual, donde la economía nos empieza a dar alegrías, a dar síntomas de mejora, conceptos como la competitividad, el desarrollo, el crecimiento, no tendrían ningún sentido si no se sustentan sobre una Europa social, sobre el bienestar y sobre la calidad de vida de las personas. Ningún sentido. Erronka hor dago gagoz gu. Eta gure bete beharra argia da. Erakundeak neurri eraginkorrak hartu behar doguz, betetzeko moduko neurriak. Ekonomiaren suspertzeriakin batera, pertsonen ongizatea bilatzen jarraitu behar dugu, denon artean. Es prioritario disponer de una política ordenada y eficaz que nos permita trazar un camino sin retorno, sin vuelta atrás, para la mejora sostenida de las condiciones de trabajo en nuestro territorio. Basado en estas premisas, en clara sintonía con el marco estratégico de salud y seguridad en el trabajo europeo, también nosotros en Euskadi hemos elaborado la Estrategia Vasca de Seguridad y Salud, que estará en vigor hasta 2020. Estrategia basada en una idea simple. Y todo lo simple es, al final, profundo. Un entorno de trabajo seguro y saludable como parte de una vida saludable. Y si no lo haces por ti, hazlo por mí, como me dijo a mí mi hijo con 7 años. Pertsonen ongizateari begira lan inguru osasuntzean murgiltzea ezinbestekoa dalako. El bienestar de las personas exige que nos desenvolvamos en entornos de trabajo saludable, que la actividad laboral, lejos de dañarnos, sea una fuente de satisfacción que impacte de forma positiva en nuestra vida psicológica, familiar, social y laboral, y también en nuestra salud. Hay que trabajar con satisfacción, hay que trabajar con vocación, hay que trabajar en buenas condiciones, porque eso fomenta la vida saludable, fomenta la implicación de las personas también en los objetivos de las empresas, también fomenta el trabajo en la vida para la mejora continua y fomenta, en definitiva, la competitividad de nuestras empresas, que va en favor de los trabajadores y de las trabajadoras de nuestros países. Esta idea de un entorno de trabajo seguro y saludable, como parte de una vida saludable, que a buen seguro todos compartimos, todos necesitamos sentirla posible. Necesitamos entender que es alcanzable, y hay una cosa que tenemos los que tenemos alguna acumulación de juventud, y es que todo lo que queremos somos capaces de hacerlo. Querer es poder. En este sentido, encuentros como el de hoy y el de mañana, centrados en compartir experiencias positivas, prácticas, encaminadas a divulgar el conocimiento y a fomentar los lugares de trabajo saludables y el manejo del estrés, son de vital importancia. Jardunaldu hauekaz gizarteari mezu bat bidaltzen diogu. Gure osasunari kalte egin leiken faktoreek gure arreta merezi dutela. Arrisku laboralen prebentzioa tresna bat dela. En definitiva, buscamos una sociedad implicada y que participe activamente en la prevención de los riesgos laborales, que fomente y mantenga comportamientos seguros y actitudes coherentes con estilos de vida saludables. Buscamos convertir la prevención en un rasgo propio, un rasgo cultural también de nuestra sociedad, de la sociedad vasca. Queremos ser un ejemplo en muchas cosas y también queremos ser un ejemplo en esto. Y como queremos serlo, podemos serlo, y como podemos serlo, seremos. En una sociedad cambiante como la nuestra, afrontar el futuro resulta imprescindible. Tener la capacidad para hacer frente a nuevos retos que afecten a la prevención de riesgos y a los posibles cambios de escenarios que a buen seguro estarán presentes. Los factores de riesgos psicosociales son un fenomenal ejemplo para ello. Hace ya bastante tiempo fueron considerados como factores de riesgo capaces de dañar la salud de las personas trabajadoras. Y cuando se daña la salud, no se daña solo el trabajo que uno realiza, se daña la familia, se daña el entorno, se daña a la sociedad, se daña al país. Hoy, aunque quede un largo camino por recorrer para llegar a nuestra correcta, a una correcta y a una eficaz prevención, avanzamos ciertamente en la sensibilización y existe un amplio consenso en torno al efecto nocivo que factores como el estrés tienen sobre la salud de las personas. Pertsonak dira gakoa, pertsonei begira, pertsonei zuzendutako neurriak hartu behar doguzelako. Termino. Poniendo el foco en las personas encontramos el sentido de nuestra tarea. Estar preparados para afrontar nuevos riesgos derivados de los cambios de los escenarios laborales y de los escenarios sociales y abordar la adaptación del trabajo a las nuevas condiciones y a las capacidades de las personas. La prevención de riesgos laborales, cómo no, tiene que centrarse en las personas. Compromiso con las personas es nuestra seña de identidad como gobierno. En nombre del Gobierno Vasco, en el mío propio, me permito daros la bienvenida a Bilbao, la bienvenida a Euskadi. Espero que disfrutéis de la estancia. Ongi etorri, ondo izan, bihotzean gorde betirako gure hiria Bilbo eta gure herria Euskadi. Eskerrik asko.
Eskerrik asko, Toña Jauna. And thank you for the ongoing support to the agency from the Basque government. So now I'm hoping that the social partners will help me to stay within the time. So I hope they will not exceed the 5 minutes that I've allocated to them, and I hope they will do so in good humor and good spirits. I'm particularly talking to you, Kris de Meester. First of all, I am very happy to welcome my compatriot, Esther Lynch from Ireland, who is a newly elected Confederal Secretary to the European Trade Union Confederation. And it's Esther's first time taking part in our summit here in Bilbao. Before taking up her new job in Brussels last month, she was the Legislation and Social Affairs Officer of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, where she also had a seat on the board of the Irish Health and Safety Authority, the European Commission's Advisory Committee on the Free Movement of Workers, and also various other places, including the ILO in Geneva. Esther holds a degree in management and law. She lectures in law, and she's currently completing a master's degree in media. When I asked Esther for her secret to winding down at home, although I did wonder if she ever gets any free time at all, given that she's just moved to Brussels and starting a new job and everything, she said family is number one. Family is where she does most of her relaxing. But she does have an unusual way of winding down. She volunteers, and she volunteers as a clown. And she is part of a group, she calls them the Theatre of the Oppressed, where they do clowning to confront difficult issues with different segments of society. So she's now looking for opportunities in Brussels to expand. So if any of you know a little bit about clowning opportunities in Brussels, do let me know afterwards. Esther.
So, thank you, Brenda, distinguished delegates, colleagues, and I hope some friends. As Brenda said, I was elected 4 weeks ago, and last week I attended my first Executive Council meeting. At that meeting, my first presentation was on the field of health, safety and welfare at work. I was struck by the number of affiliates who took the floor, and without exception, all of them talked about stress at work. Regardless of the country they were coming from, regardless of the sector of worker that they represented, regardless of the occupations of those workers, all of the unions were describing different stresses, all of which were preventable, all of which were predictable. I don't have enough time in the 5 minutes to describe all of the different situations, but there are some common themes that I'd like you to think about as part of your considerations. The first one was people were describing how workers are frankly being overmanaged and over-monitored. People were describing targets that you couldn't hope to achieve, targets the workers didn't understand and frankly seemed more about completing a form for somebody at the level of the board 6 months from now rather than helping the worker to do their work. Other unions were describing how people were being over-monitored so that people, every second of their day, every stroke on the computer was looked at. So you couldn't have a bad moment, let alone a bad day. Other unions were describing to me stigma, so that people were saying, look, I'd like to raise the issue of stress, but I'm afraid that if I do, I won't be promoted. And when I go for another job, the first thing I'll be handed is a form that says, in the past, have you ever complained of stress? The other, and it struck me just how bad this must really be for workers, was they described a situation of precariousness where the person didn't know from day to day, from week to week, what hours they would be called in to work. And the consequence of that, not only the obvious stress of not being able to manage your family life, not only, you know, how will I get to work, what time will I start, what do I need to do tomorrow, but the consequence of making a mistake. The consequence for those workers for making a mistake wasn't that you get told off, it's that they wouldn't be called in for work, they'd effectively be dismissed. And I can only imagine the stress that that must be causing to those workers. But of course, this is only half the story. The other half of the story is all of you who have been working to show leadership, to come up with solutions, to identify realistic ways that workers, their unions, management, government, labor inspectorates can work together to come up with actual ways to address stress within the workplace. And here's my final point. What are we going to do about the other half? The other half who don't care, who don't care about excellence, who aren't going to put it right, who are going to undercut everybody who is putting it right. What are we going to do about them? And I'd encourage you to think about that as well, and certainly to the Commission within the next year to come up with realistic solutions. If we can't encourage people to do it properly, we'll have to make them. Thank you.
Thank you, Esther. Thank you for keeping within the time limit, Esther. I appreciate that. I wonder, can the employers do the same? So the second of our social partner representatives is Christa Meester, and no stranger to the agency. He's the chair of the Health and Safety Group of Business Europe. He holds degrees in chemical and agricultural engineering, an MBA, and also special degrees in environmental science and health and safety. He also works for the Belgian Federation of Employers, specializing in health, safety, and well-being at work. He represents them in various positions, such as the boards of EU-OSHA, Eurofound, the Advisory Committee in Luxembourg, and the ILO. Kris is also an entrepreneur running several companies specializing in OSH training and support. When I asked Kris to tell me how he likes to unwind after a lot of work and travel, and those of us who know him, it's no surprise, he told me live music concerts. That's all Christa Meester needs. So Kris, 5 minutes for you.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for those words, Brenda. Colleagues, friends, I did bring some images to support my presentation. That is to prevent my face spread all over the screen there. So 2 years ago, 2 years of collecting and disseminating information, research, good practices and tools about the psychosocial aspects of work in general, and stress in particular, culminate today in this closing event of the 2014-2015 Healthy Workplaces campaign. Now, this topic is extremely important for the business community. We want our workers to deliver a productive contribution. We want to see them engaged. We do not want them to disconnect. So the key question is, how do we create an organization where people are able and willing to do their best work? And in answering that question, our views and approaches probably differ slightly from what you read and hear in most of the campaign tools. But we are going in the same direction, prevent and improve. We would like to stress the importance of an approach that transcends health and safety and focuses on all aspects of work, now and in the future. When we organized our own event as Business Europe, we approached the topic first of all from a scientific angle with a view on the future of work based on research, analysis and metadata before focusing on successful and sustainable approaches in the field. Now, what was striking is the fact that success does not stem from a technical approach with risk assessment, prevention measures, and procedures, but from a far broader action that puts people in the center. Enthusiastic workers, people that work with deep affection and pride, that is where the win-win lies for companies and workers. We must strive to deploy people based on their talents and skills, craft jobs around people's capacities, taking into account their personal needs and aspirations. No longer simply command and control by management, but a facilitating work environment. Authentic leadership, servant leaders, that is the model of the future and a huge lever for healthy workplaces. It means leadership aimed at personal development and support. Traditional management and leadership is about arranging and telling. True, authentic leadership is about nurturing and enhancing. Now, this slide is here because 2 years ago, and you can look at the photos of the event 2 years ago, I made a statement regarding the hairdressers sector, the hairdressers agreement. Now, yesterday, by coincidence, I met some of the people of the hairdressers sector. They are actually co-fellow Belgian people. And we started to talk about their sector, their branch. Now, their branch is characterized by a lot of self-employed people that work alone and a minority of hairdressers that do employ workers. But their business is all about people. All the work takes place, the employer and the workers and the clients, they are all in the same room. They have little capacity for absorbing technical procedures, risk assessment, etc. But they can improve by building upon authentic people. Authentic people, leaders from the sector, from the branch association, but also individual hairdressers that show the good example. And we started to talk about a hairdresser that I know from my hometown that they also knew that was really an example in this field. And I will tell you more about the anecdotes later on. So forget about the collective approach when it comes to psychosocial aspects. Don't be afraid to look at the individual. No collective system, no risk assessment tool is capable of capturing the true needs, personality, and aspirations of individuals. So allow individual workers within a certain frame to decide when, where, and how to work to get results. Design jobs for autonomy, meaningfulness, progress, and competence. That is participation. involvement and engagement in the true sense of the word. Avoid over-focusing on strengthening your workers' weak points or points for improvement, because such an approach consumes a lot of energy and causes stress and frustration. Focus instead on their strengths. Allow them to further develop their talents. Allow them to discover and bring out new competencies. Unfold other talents that might serve your company. It is clear that this is a two-sided story with duties and responsibilities for both employers and workers. Autonomy and participation also means that workers will have to reflect more on their talents and competencies, that they will have to evaluate what they really want and make choices in a continuous quest for a job, a function, tasks, an employer, and a work environment that fits them, and this throughout their whole career. And if we want our labor force to be creative and innovative, capable of dealing with change and working longer, a climate of respect and trust is indispensable. There is no miracle solution in order to keep workers enthusiastic and productive. Stress has always existed and will always be there. Those are not my words, but they are coming from the scientific community. It is clear, however, that we can do better, and a lot of companies already do so. The award winners are just the tip of the iceberg. There are plenty of great places to work. At the same time, I agree with Esther Lynch, a lot is still to be done. It is clear from what I said, from best practices, that putting the worker in the middle yields best results. And here I would like to mention 2 weeks ago, Estonia, Tallinn, a conference where there was also an award given to the best place to work in Estonia. And later on, the award winners came to me, Kris, everything you said in your presentation about authentic leadership, autonomy, focus on results, we do all that in our company. So my conclusion, it's not OSH, it's all elements from the overarching world of work. Trust and mutual respect are the best soil for motivated, healthy, and enthusiastic workers and sustainable jobs. The right man or woman on the right place, with an outcome-based workload in balance with their capacities, sufficient autonomy, support, and development possibilities in the company or on the broader labor market. That is the best prevention against stress. This does not imply naive, frivolous freedom. Let go where possible, detain where necessary. And a vigilant surrounding, because even workers given that autonomy, trust, and support can derail by willing to be too good, going too hard. I wish you all an inspiring summit. Thank you.